Hello, welcome to the How to Boot to a Shell with the TI Processor's Linux SDK for AM3X, AM4X, and AM5X processors. What's in this video? First, the single shell boot is about bypassing a full user space initialization. The default out of box for the TI Processor's Linux SDK is essentially booting a desktop. There are lots of user space daemons getting initiated, and we'll see that later on in this video showing everything that's getting booted as part of the default SDK. Booting to a single shell or thread allows a minimal environment application setup from which any impact from user space on performance issues can be isolated. Additionally, this can be used to isolate initial system bring-up issues such as board port, boot time, and even if the end application design is also a single shell. This technique is a quick alternative as it uses the out-of-box components of the TI Processor's Linux SDK without having to configure and build a utility such as BusyBox. As part of this video, we'll also demonstrate how to change the kernel user space initialization to boot to a shell or single thread using, again, the TI Processor's Linux SDK. As the kernel approaches the end of its initialization, it's going to look to try and launch user space. It's going to look in a directory called bin in your root file system, and then look for init, and then try to execute it. The TI Processor's Linux SDK uses systemd for user space. The rest of this video will be about changing that launch of systemd to the single shell script that we're going to try and launch, which will then give us a single shell boot that we're looking for. So let's take a look at a running board. Here we have a freshly booted board that's running the TI Processor's out-of-box Linux SDK. We're going to type psaux, which is going to show us all the running threads currently on the system. As you can see, by all the threads that are printed out on the screen, there's quite a few things that are running. A lot of systemd services have been started, a PTP service has been started, a telnetd service has been started. These are all part of the standard services that are all running as part of the out-of-box Linux SDK. The goal of our boot to a shell script is to bypass all these daemons and services that are getting started that you see here with the normal out-of-box SDK. So after setting up our shell script, that we're going to be using it as our fixed application, the only thing left running will be the kernel threads and our boot to a script shell. Before moving on, I want to point out where the initialization function is that the kernel is calling after it finishes its initialization. So scrolling back to the top of where the psaux command starts printing out its results, is you'll see that PID1 is pointing to the sbin init. This is the first PID that is launched by the kernel as it comes out of initialization. This is what we're going to be replacing with our boot to shell application. Before talking about the script you're going to create, you have to be able to tell the kernel to not use this default user space initialization. For more information, the init process itself is discussed in the kernel source tree in the documentation directory in a file called init.txt. Setting the init source can be done with a command line parameter to tell the kernel where to try to launch the init process from. After you finish making your file, you'll place it in the bin directory and make sure it is executable. Use the command ls-la to make sure the file is executable. In the next slide, we're going to talk about what's actually inside the file that's going to be used for your single shell init. Example script that can be used for a boot shell. You're going to create this file using vi on the target EVM. In this example, the file is created in the bin directory of the root file system and is set as executable. It's very important that the file is set as executable, otherwise the boot will hang as the kernel comes out of initialization. The gray box is showing the contents of the script that we're creating. You can see we're going to create a shell, and then we're going to mount the proc and sysfs in their respective directories. We're going to export the path for sbin and user sbin so that a lot of the normal functions, such as ifconfig, are going to work. Then we're going to change to the user directory, in this case, which is root. So we're going to change directory to /home/root. And then we're going to launch another shell, and this shell is what you'll be using as your single shell workspace. In this shell is where you'll be launching your various commands of things you're trying to test, and also this would represent a single shell application. After editing our file, there are two steps that have to be performed to make sure that the file actually gets used now for initialization. The first step is to halt the boot process inside of uboot, and then use setenv to set the init command line parameter for the kernel. We're going to highlight this later on in the video. After setting that environment variable, now we can boot into Linux with a bootd command. And finally, there is a link here at the bottom which points to this the script and a couple of these steps that are defined on this particular wiki. All right, now that we've discussed the script, let's actually look at it on a actual EVM. In this system, the script's already been entered, and I'm going to use vi here to take a look at what's inside the file. As you can see, it's what was on the previous page. We're starting a shell. We're going to mount proc and sysfs to the respective directories. We're going to export the path for sbin and user sbin, and then we're going to set the home directory to home root, and then we're going to launch another shell. All right, now that we've finished editing the file, this is where we need to make sure that the our boot_app.sh is executable. So we're going to use the chmod command, add the executable flag to our file. And then we're going to do the ls-la on it to double check to make sure that the file is executable. And then finally, I'm going to highlight here showing you the actual file is executable. All right, so now I've rebooted the EVM. I'm going to press reset, and then I'm going to stop the boot process right when it's in U-boot. Just as a refresher, you can use the space bar as the U-boot count is counting down. Okay, I've reset the terminal because I like to keep as much as I can on the screen. We're still inside of U-boot on the EVM. So now I'm going to type in that setenv command that's going to pass an optional argument to the kernel. Here I'm resetting the init, or I'm telling the kernel to say I want the init to come from our /bin/boot_app.sh file. So after I've entered that into U-boot, now I'm ready to boot the kernel, and I'm just going to type in bootd. So as the kernel boots now, it's going to take that init command that we just passed here for this environment variable, and it's going to use that to look for our boot_app.sh in the bin directory instead of looking for systemd. All right, so now we're going to boot the kernel, and you're going to see that it comes up very fast, and it's going to come up to our user shell that we created. The first thing you'll notice this from other different Linux boots is that there's a whole lot of things that get set up in user space that didn't print out. As you can see, we're in our single shell, and we're at a 3.2.version shell. All right, earlier we used psaux to show us all the running threads in the system. We use that again here to show us all the threads that are now running in our single shell system. As you can see, there's still quite a few threads, but these are all kernel threads. All right, so while we have our psaux output here, let's go ahead and scroll up and see what PID1 is equal to. And as we scroll up, you'll see that PID1 is equal to the boot app that we passed in on the command line. And also, let's go ahead and scroll back up even further and look at, as the kernel is initializing, we're going to find where the kernel command line is. We're going to see that the command line passed in, our init, is equal to /bin/boot_app.sh. All right, now that we have our single shell user environment, let's run through a couple of examples to kind of show how this is going to work. First, we're going to echo out the path that we put into our shell program, so you can see that is what we intended. Next, let's try and bring up Ethernet. So looking at Ethernet, you can see the interface is not up and we don't have an IP address. So let's first bring up the interface with Ether0 up. Now the interface is up. Let's see if we have an IP address. We still don't. So now we need to use UDHCPC for Ether0 to go out and get an IP address. There's our address. And so we've run ifconfig again at Ether0. We'll see that we have our IP address. So the reason you have to do this is because since we didn't bring up a user space, a lot of the network management stuff didn't get started. So therefore, you have to do it manually. So that's why we had to bring up the interface, then we had to go out and get an IP address. This kind of highlights just how, I guess, raw the single user shell is. There's nothing really defined. You have to define everything, such as like we're defining the path, we're defining the like the procfs that we're using and the sysfs that we're using. Everything you want in your single shell, you will have to specifically call out into your shell program. All right, so before we go, I have to mention there is at least a couple of drawbacks. All the usual interactivity of a login shell is missing. What this means essentially is that there is no control C to kill the foreground task as you're executing it. An example here would be is if you start ping and don't put it to the background, it's going to keep running. So you'll have to actually reboot the board to kill the task. Again, this is a single shell, single task. You'll have to push any other applications you want to launch to the background. Just let me remind you, this is intended as a simple, quick tool for isolation of performance issues that might be introduced by user space. This technique can also be used to quickly evaluate how or what a single shell or fixed application and how it might perform. This could also be used during the early stages of board port. Remember, this technique is bypassing what the SDK is normally booting, which is a desktop-like environment. Here are some additional links that you may consider taking a look at. Also included here again is the link to the Wiki page that has the script that we talked about in this video. Thank you for watching this video on how to boot to a single shell.